Our next speaker is Joseph Thornton. Joe Thornton. Joe is one of the great environmental intellectuals of our time, in my opinion. He is an associate professor in the Center for Ecology and Evolutionary Biology in the Department of Biology at the University of Oregon. Joe came to academia later in life than most. He built a spectacular career at Greenpeace and then moved to a research position at Columbia University. He's highly awarded. I know him best for his wonderful book, Pandora's Poison, which I reviewed for Nature. It's a tour de force investigation and analysis of the chlorine industry with careful, thought-out suggestions for public policy responses to the many conundrums that we have from the chlorine industry. At Oregon, Joe works on the evolution of gene function aimed at understanding the evolutionary dynamics that have determined how genes, or more accurately, the proteins they code for, got their functions. Of special significance for today's lecture, he also studies the molecular evolution of hormones and the receptors with a focus on vertebrate steroid hormones such as estrogen, testosterone, and the stress level hormone cortisol, and the receptor proteins that mediate these hormones' effects on the body cells. He also works on phylogenetic techniques for analyzing gene family evolution. Please welcome Joe Thornton.
Thanks, Terry, for that wonderful introduction. I wonder, would you be willing to travel with me everywhere I go and give that introduction, including to my mom? So there are many areas of common ground between green chemistry and the environmental health sciences, including the ethical imperative to protect the health of future generations. But in material terms, where the two fields meet is at the level of molecular biology, where the chemicals that humans use with their specific properties meet the molecular signaling mechanisms that drive biology. So today, I'd like to discuss the biological basis at the molecular level for our biology and draw out 11 principles that have implications for green chemistry, environmental health science, and environmental policy. Number one, biology is driven by biochemical signals. You have on the order of a trillion cells in your body, but your body is an integrated organism. So how does it function this way? It's because of chemical signals that allow the different cells in the body to communicate with each other and coordinate their actions together. So the most well-known of these signals are hormones, which are produced in the glands, such as in the gonads, or in the adrenal glands, or in other glands such as the thyroid gland, or glands that are adjacent to the brain. These hormones circulate through your bloodstream. They go to virtually all tissues in the body where they trigger biological responses. Now, there are, in addition to hormones, there are many other kind of signaling mechanisms. So I don't want to limit myself just to endocrine disruption and hormones. We also have to think about neurotransmitters that allow nerve signals to coordinate their activity together. Or we also need to think about growth factors that allow developing tissues to communicate with each other and allow the coordinated processes of development to take place. Now, these signals are entirely responsible for the processes of development, for the differentiation and proliferation of tissues, not only in development, but also in cancer. They control reproduction and behavior, and also the maintenance of homeostasis and the control of metabolism. So it's all about biochemical signaling. Chemicals are the information that your body uses to behave as a body. Number two, most signals are mediated by protein receptors. Now this cartoon here shows you the mode of action for an estrogen receptor, for example. The hormones are fat soluble, so they diffuse through cell membranes. Receptor proteins, a specific receptor protein for each hormone or group of hormones, is present in the cytosol of the cell. In the absence of hormone, it is in an inactive conformation, so it doesn't do anything. But upon binding of the ligand, it changes its conformation, in a way that allows it to bind to DNA and, in particular, recruit other proteins that up or down regulate a target gene that's flanked by the response element where the receptor binds. Now, this graphic here shows you the atomic structure of a typical nuclear receptor. In the absence of ligand, it is in an inactive conformation. This helix is particularly important. Without the ligand, it's down here. But all nuclear receptors, upon binding of the ligand, here, nestled into the so-called ligand binding pocket, change their conformation and flip this helix up. And this new surface is assembled right here, and that is where the co-regulator proteins bind. So the ability to bind any given chemical, a hormone, or a xenobiotic chemical, is determined by the surface properties of this pocket, the amino acids that line this pocket, and the surface properties of the hormone or xenobiotic. Number three, some or even many synthetic chemicals activate these receptors fortuitously. Now, although they have many things in common, and we'll talk specifically about what's in common between hormones and their synthetic disruptors, they're also not exactly the same by any means. So here's estradiol, the primary ligand for the estrogen receptor. And here's diethylstilbestrol. You can see that, which is a very potent estrogen receptor agonist, meaning it activates the estrogen receptor. You can see they're about the same size, and they both share an aromatic ring here with a hydroxyl group. But other than that, that's about it. In three dimensions, there are radical differences. Now, this doesn't mean the estrogen receptor will bind anything. It won't be activated by testosterone, which is actually more similar in shape to estradiol, but it differs in a crucial way that we'll talk about. It has this extra methyl group up here. So there's actually a wide range of compounds with very different chemical structures in a wide range of different classes, steroids, stilbenes, other kinds of aromatics, that will activate the estrogen in particular. And you see several of them here. Again, you probably wouldn't have been able to predict that these would be estrogen receptor activators. Number four, receptors are only as specific as they need to be. And this is because of evolution. Our hormone receptors evolved more than 400 million years ago. Now, let's look at the atomic structure of the estrogen receptor in complex with estradiol, its natural ligand. You can see that here's that ring with the hydroxyl group on it. The hormone is nicely nestled into this pocket, and this is called the A ring. It's coordinated by hydrogen bonds here. And in fact, there's quite a lot of extra room around this side of the hormone, the middle and what's called the D ring, the B, C, and D rings. So there's quite a bit of room. Now let's look at the crystal structure with DES. It binds it in almost exactly the same fashion, particularly on this A ring. These bonds are conserved. And the receptor had ample room to accommodate these extra atoms in these other dimensions that are present in DES. Now, why does it do this? There are many receptors that are more specific than the estrogen receptor, but it turns out that receptors are only as specific as they have to be in the sense that estrogens are the only compounds made by your body that are approximately this size and have an aromatic ring over here with a hydroxyl group. Testosterone doesn't have this, neither do any of your other steroid hormones. So this receptor could be promiscuous in its ability to bind these chemicals because it never saw these chemicals until about 50 years ago. So the fact of endocrine disruption by synthetic chemicals is because these chemicals are produced during recent times and interact with receptors that didn't see them for hundreds of millions of years of evolution. Now, because of this, it means that every receptor is potentially disruptible by synthetic compounds because the time scales of industrial production and evolutionary time are vastly different. Number five, in addition to these agonists, activators, there are a large number of synthetic chemicals that block receptor activity. So while the agonists make your body think that it's producing estrogen and respond appropriately, the antagonists will prevent the body's estrogen from doing its job. Now, why should there be more antagonists than agonists? And the answer is that the receptor's pocket can bind many different chemicals that will almost fit into it. But it has to fit just right to allow the receptor to take on the agonist conformation, as it did with estrogen. And here's that helix that I showed you before. Well, what happens when the receptor binds an antagonist, which is bulkier, it's bigger? It's still got that, that A ring, but out here on the D ring, it's got all sorts of other stuff. Well, this other stuff pushes these helices out of the way, and in the structure with the antagonist, this activation surface is disassembled, this gets pushed out of the way, and now you have a receptor that's occupied and cannot be activated by estrogen, even if the body is producing estrogen. Number six. Estrogen receptor is just one pair of proteins in a gene family called the steroid receptor gene family. The reason I said two is that we have two estrogen receptors, alpha and beta. Their specificity for different ligands is similar. And as we've already heard, these are major regulators of male and female development, reproduction, cardiovascular health, brain function, and they're major risk factors for breast and other cancers. But there are other members of the same family, each with unique ligand specificity. So we anticipate them to be activated or antagonized by different chemicals from the ER and different chemicals from each other. And the players are the glucocorticoid receptor, activated by the stress hormone cortisol. Disruption of this has the potential to disrupt your body's response to stress, control of metabolism, and immunity. The MR, mineralocorticoid receptor, is activated by aldosterone, another hormone from your adrenal gland, and this regulates salt and water balance. So it's the major regulator of blood pressure, function of your kidney and colon, and is an important player in cardiovascular health. The AR is activated by testosterone, major regulator of male development, reproduction, prostate cancer, and the PR is regulated by another hormone, progesterone, plays major roles in female development, reproduction, and cancer. Now, there are numerous chemicals that have already been found to be disruptors for the other members of the family. Mostly pesticides are the major ones that have been documented to date. Now, these substances are mostly antagonists, and that's because these receptors are less promiscuous than the estrogen receptors. But make no mistake about the potential effects of antagonists. Now, we already heard that these receptors bind their ligands at nanomolar affinity, parts per trillion, the equivalent of a few drops of hormone in a railroad car of serum is enough to result in the difference between the phenotypic difference between an adult male and an adult female. So tiny doses of these antagonists or agonists have the potential at environmental concentrations to cause profound effects on our biology. One thing to note about all of these antagonists and agonists is that they're all lipophilic, and many are quite long-lived in the environment. Number seven, steroid receptors are just a subfamily in a very large family of genes called nuclear receptors, which all share an evolutionary ancestor at the very base of the animal kingdom. So these include the receptors for almost every hydrophobic hormone or metabolite or nutrient that has an effect on your body. They're key regulators of development, reproduction, and homeostasis. Retinoids play key roles in development, in vision, in reproduction. They are the major receptors for cholesterol and their metabolites in the regulation of cholesterol homeostasis. We heard about metabolic syndrome and the role of nuclear receptors. Outside of the vertebrates, these are the key regulators of metamorphosis in insects. Thyroid hormones regulate metamorphosis in amphibians, as well as regulating metabolism and brain development and function in humans, for example. And vitamin D is a major regulator of cancer, bone development, and metabolism as well. So this is a huge superfamily. Now let's look at the evolutionary history of the superfamily. Here's the tree going back to the common ancestral gene right here, before the last common ancestor of you and a sea sponge. It had one nuclear receptor, and the tree represents the series of gene duplications and divergence of DNA sequence that led to the incredible functional diversity of nuclear receptors in your body. Now, all of the colored ones here have identified ligands, meaning they're activated by hormones that are known. So these include fatty acids, retinoids, phospholipids, the steroid hormones, heme, derivatives of cholesterol, bile acids, glucose, and oxysterols, an incredible diversity of natural ligands. There are many receptors whose natural ligands have not yet been identified, so appreciate the that we have barely begun to scratch the surface of the biological complexity of the system with our current knowledge. Many of these receptors are already known to be affected by some endocrine active compounds in the environment, including pesticides and industrial chemicals, and therefore the scope of potential biological effects on our body is extremely vast. Now, here are the receptors that have identified xenobiotics that disrupt them. This is despite the fact that most of these have not been very well studied. There's just a few, a little bit of information here and there. The thing to notice is that all of these ligands are hydrophobic, and most of them are between 250 and 500 cubic angstroms in volume. So this is information that may be relevant to green chemists. These are the sorts of chemicals that it's particularly important to avoid the production and release of into the environment. Number eight, it's not just nuclear receptors. If you think that the nuclear receptors are bad enough, it goes well beyond that. There are other families of receptors. For example, the AH receptor functions in a similar way to the way nuclear receptors do. It's an intracellular receptor that directly activates transcription, but it's a completely unrelated gene family, and the ligands for it are completely unrelated. A very large number, hundreds of compounds, have been identified, produced by industry, that activate the AH receptor, including the dioxins. Second group, membrane receptors for steroids. Steroids don't only act through those receptors I showed you before, they also have fast actions through receptors of different families that are stuck in the cell membrane. And upon binding the hormone at the membrane, these receptors will interact with other proteins in the cell, change their state, which will lead to a change in the state of the cell, including activation of different target genes than those that are activated by the steroid receptors. And a number of pesticides in particular have already been identified as agonists or antagonists of these membrane receptors. GABA receptors are neurotransmitters in the brain. They're responsible for nerves being able to talk to each other through a process similar to this one. There are a number of pesticides that are known to disrupt signaling through the GABA receptor. And finally, there's a whole range of other receptors in the body, receptors for growth factors and development, many other neurotransmitter receptors, and so on, none of which, to my knowledge, have ever been tested for their susceptibility to disruption by xenobiotic chemicals. So in addition to the little bit of information we have about these guys, we know virtually nothing about endocrine disruption of these mechanisms. Finally, I should note that for many of the nuclear receptors, some of the less well-known ones, as well as all of these except for the AH receptor, we don't have good validated toxicological assays. So we are not in a position to systematically assess the chemicals that are out there in the environment for their impacts on our health through these kinds of mechanisms. Number nine, well, it's not just receptors. Pollutants can also disrupt biological signaling by non-receptor mechanisms. So we've already talked about membrane receptors, and we already talked about hormones acting through the nuclear receptors, which bind to response elements and activate target genes. But there are other ways that chemicals in the environment can and do disrupt biological signaling. For example, they're known to change the rates of hormone synthesis or metabolism, that is clearance, and therefore they'll change the levels of estrogen or testosterone in your body. A number of examples are known. So you end up with more or less hormone, resulting in either a hormone or anti-hormone-like response. Some chemicals are known to change the concentration of receptors that are present in the cell. And if there are more receptors, that will potentiate the effect of a fixed level of a hormone in your body. So by upregulating, for example, the levels of estrogen receptor, you can have an estrogen-like effect without changing the presence of estrogen or estrogen-like chemicals. There are a number of synthetic chemicals that bind to serum binding proteins. These are proteins in the blood that bind to hormones and either sequester them or have a direct signaling role themselves. By sequestering a hormone, this will reduce the effective concentration of a hormone in the blood. But if these are all occupied by synthetic chemicals, then the effective level of the hormone in the blood goes up, and you can get a hormone-like effect. Finally, I should mention that these signal cascades, which control the cell's state, have also been found to affect hormone signaling by other mechanisms. For instance, there's a signaling cascade that affects the state of the coactivator proteins that bind to nuclear receptors. And these can be sort of superactivated by short-chain fatty acids. In that case, exposure to short-chain fatty acids will radically potentiate the effect of estrogen, for example, on breast cancer cells. And finally, there are many other signaling mechanisms that have not been studied for their susceptibility to endocrine disruption. Now, let me mention a couple of important endocrine disruptors. These are known from their effects on the organism to have major biological effects, but I don't think we yet understand the mechanisms by which they act. BPA is normally thought of as an estrogen, but the levels of BPA required to activate the estrogen receptor in vitro or in cell culture are far higher than the levels that are required to produce the effects during development on the organism. So there is likely to be something else going on other than being an estrogen receptor agonist. Atrazine, the herbicide, is well known for its effects on gonadal differentiation in amphibians. And it's known that this will affect signaling by a protein called SF1, which is crucial in sexual differentiation. However, it's not an agonist or an antagonist for SF1, so we don't know how it's doing it. Again, our knowledge of these systems barely scratches the surface of the true biological complexity. Number 10, biochemical signaling and disruption are incredibly taxonomically diverse. I've mostly been talking about humans, but let's remember that nuclear receptors and other receptors that can, in principle or in fact, be disrupted by xenobiotic compounds are found throughout all the kingdoms of life, including bacteria. Bacteria are known to be disrupted by several pesticides. There are nuclear receptors in the cnidaria, in anemones and jellyfish. They play key roles in a number of species that play crucial roles in ecological processes such as pollination, such as nitrogen fixation, such as food web in the soil or in the ocean. So it's possible that disruption by chemicals of signaling in these species could have widespread ecological effects, although this has been studied hardly at all. And finally, number 11, we cannot possibly hope to identify every endocrine active compound or every signaling molecule, every xenobiotic that disrupts biological signaling mechanisms. Current policies generally presume chemicals to be safe until they've been demonstrated hazardous. It takes a very heavy burden of proof to justify ending the production or discharge of a chemical. But in reality, there are some 100,000 chemicals in commerce, plus myriad additional byproducts and breakdown products, and many of these compounds aren't even identified chemically yet. Of this vast number, only a tiny fraction have been tested for endocrine disruption or other forms of signal disruption. Now, of these fraction that have been tested, hundreds or thousands of endocrine-active chemicals are already known, so out of this whole universe, it's likely that the number of true signal disruptors is very, very large. Now, EPA has recognized the problem that only a tiny fraction have been tested for signal disruption. So they began an ambitious testing program to identify all the estrogen, androgen, and thyroid receptor signal disruptors. But as I've shown you today, that barely scratches the surface of what we need to take into account. So in conclusion, what does this mean for green chemistry and environmental health policy? Well, if we want to prevent health impacts by substances that disrupt the endocrine system and other signaling mechanisms, we need to shift the way we regulate policies, in my opinion. The current reactive chemical-by-chemical policy regime is inadequate. Vast numbers of chemicals are not being regulated, even though they pose significant potential threats to our health. Environmental policies should be precautionary. We shouldn't require specific proof that any single individual chemical has caused damage to human health when there are far too many for us possibly to generate that sort of information about. Policy should be precautionary in the sense that substances that we have a good reason to believe may cause damage to health and the environment should be avoided whenever alternatives are available. What kind of substances should we avoid? Well, we should particularly avoid the ones that are likely to disrupt biological signaling, the ones with certain properties, that is, they're persistent in the environment or in the body, and especially if they're lipophilic. And we should avoid chemical classes that are likely to disrupt signaling based on their fundamental chemical properties and also what we know about the many chemicals that have been studied, such as the organohalogens, which represent the bulk of the identified endocrine disruptors to date. And finally, in addition to changes in environmental health policy, we might be able to reorient practice in green chemistry and environmental health sciences toward these goals by focusing less on single examples of the myriad chemicals out there and trying to enlarge our general knowledge of the biological systems that are affected by these substances and begin to focus on classes and properties of chemicals that make them threats to our health. Thank you.